I was sick, sick unto death with that long agony. And when they at length unbound me and I was permitted to sit up, I felt that my senses were leaving me. The sentence, the dread sentence of death, was the last of distinct accentuation which reached my ears. I felt that I lay upon my back unbound. I reached out my hand and it fell heavily upon something damp and hard. I found beside me a loaf and a pitcher with water and ate and drank with avidity. Shortly afterward, I attempted to make a tour around my prison. I had little object, certainly no hope in these researches, but a vague curiosity prompted me to continue them. Quitting the wall, I resolved to cross the area of the enclosure, and I proceeded with extreme caution, for the floor was treacherous with slime, and even so, I slipped and fell violently on my face. A few seconds afterward, I comprehended my position. My forehead seemed bathed in a clammy vapor, and the peculiar smell of decayed fungus arose to my nostrils. I put forward my arm and shuddered to find that I had fallen at the very brink of a circular pit whose extent, of course, I had no means of ascertaining at the moment. Groping about the masonry just below the margin, I succeeded in dislodging a small fragment and let it fall into the abyss. For many seconds, I hearkened to its reverberations as it dashed against the sides of the chasm in its descent. At length, there was a sullen plunge into water. Shaking in every limb, I groped my way back to the wall, resolving there to perish rather than risk the terrors of the wells, of which my imagination now pictured many in various positions around the dungeon. In other conditions of mind, I might have had courage to end my misery at once by plunging into one of these abysses, but now I was the veriest of cowards. Agitation of spirit kept me awake for many long hours, but at length a deep sleep fell upon me, a sleep like that of death. How long it lasted, of course, I know not. But when, once again, I unclosed my eyes, the objects around me were visible. By a wild, sulphurous luster, the origin of which I could not at first determine, I was unable to see the extent and aspect of the prison. My personal condition had been greatly changed during the slumber. I now lay upon my back and at full length on a species of low framework of wood. To this, I was securely bound by a long strap resembling a surcingle, which left at liberty only my head and my left arm to such an extent that I could, by dint of much exertion, supply myself with the meat from an earthen dish which lay by my side on the floor. Something on the ceiling of the dungeon captured my attention. It was a huge pendulum which was swinging slowly. What mainly disturbed me was that with each swing, it descended perceptibly. Also, its nether extremity was formed of a crescent of glittering steel, about a foot in length from horn to horn, the horns upward, and the under edge evidently as keen as that of a razor. Like a razor, also, it seemed massy and heavy, tapering from the edge into a solid and broad structure above. It was appended to a weighty rod of brass, and the whole hissed as it swung through the air. Oh, what boots it to tell of the long, long hours of horror, more than mortal, during which I counted the rushing oscillations of steel. Inch by inch, line by line, down, and still down it came. Days passed. It might have been that many days passed ere it swept so closely over me as to fan me with its acrid breath. The odor of the sharp steel forced itself into my nostrils. I prayed, I wearied heaven with my prayer for its more speedy descent. I grew frantically mad and struggled to force myself upward against the sweep of the fearful cemeter. And then I fell suddenly calm and lay smiling at the glittering death as a child at some rare bauble. The vibrations of the pendulum was at right angle to my length. I saw that the crescent was designed to cross the region of my heart. It would fray the surge of my robe. It would return to repeat its operation again and again. Notwithstanding its terrifically wide sweep and the hissing vigor of its descent, sufficient to sunder these very walls of iron, still the fraying of my robe would be all that for several minutes it would accomplish. Down, steadily down it crept. To the right, to the left, far and wide, with the shriek of a demon spirit. I shrank convulsively at its every sweep. My eyes followed its outward and upward whirls with the eagerness of the most unmeaning despair. They closed themselves spasmodically at the descent. Although death would have been a relief, oh, how unspeakable. Still, I quivered in every nerve to think how slight a sinking of the machinery would precipitate that keen, glistening axe upon my bosom. Suddenly, there flashed upon my mind an idea, and I proceeded at once with the nervous energy of despair to attempt its execution. For many hours, the immediate vicinity of the low framework upon which I lay had been literally swarming with rats. They were wild, bold, ravenous, their red eyes glaring upon me as if they waited for motionlessness on my part to make me their prey. With particles of the oily and spicy meat, I thoroughly rubbed the strap wherever I could reach it, and then, raising my hand from the floor, I lay breathlessly still. I had not counted in vain upon the animal's voracity. Observing that I remained without motion, one or two of the boldest leaped upon the framework and smelt the surcingle. This seemed a signal for a general rush. Forth from the well, they hurried in fresh troops. They clung to the wood. They overran it and leaped in hundreds upon me. They pressed. They swarmed upon me in ever-accumulating heaps. They writhed upon my throat. Their cold lips sought my own. I was stifled by the thronging pressure. Disgust, for which the world has no name, swelled my bosom and chilled with a heavy clamminess my heart. Yet one minute, and I felt that the struggle would be over. Plainly, I perceived the loosening of the strap. At length, I was free. But the stroke of the pendulum already had divided the serge of my robe, and a sense of sharp pain shot through every nerve. At a wave of my hand, my deliverer hurried tumultuously away. With a steady movement, cautious, sidelong, shrinking, and slow, I slid from the straps and beyond the reach of the scimitar. For a moment, at least, I was free. Free, and in the grasp of the Inquisition. I had scarcely stepped from my wooden bed of horror upon the stone floor of the prison when the motion of the hellish machine ceased and was drawn up through the ceiling. My every motion was undoubtedly watched. Free. I had but escaped in one form of agony to be delivered into worse than death in some other. Even while I breathed, there came to my nostrils the breath of vapor of heated iron. A suffocating odor pervaded the prison. The heat rapidly increased, and once again I looked up, shuddering as if in a fit of ague. There had been a second change in the cell, and now the change was obvious in form. The room had been square. I saw that the heated iron walls of the cell were closing in, moving closer to me. But I neither wished nor desired them to stop. I could have clasped the red walls to my bosom as a garment of eternal peace. At length, for my seared and writhing body, there was no longer an inch of foothold on the firm floor of the prison. I struggled no more, but the agony of my soul found vent in one loud, long, and final scream of despair. I felt that I tottered on the brink of a deep pit. I averted my eyes. What? Yes, there was a discordant hum of human voices. There was a harsh grating as of a thousand thunders. The fiery walls rushed back. An outstretched arm caught my own as I fell, fainting into the abyss. It was that of General LaSalle. The French army had entered Toledo. The Inquisition was in the hands of its enemies.